I'd like to start today with a little quiz, just to make sure you're all awake. I know a few people had a late night last night. What do these groups have in common? Everybody to ever make the Wall Street Journal celebrity economist. All candidates for the presidents of the International Olympics Committee. Forbes' top 15 earning DJs. The Spectator's top 10 world thinkers list 2015. Management team at Liongate Film. Every Chief Justice of the US Supreme Court, Lord Chief Justice of England and Wales, every director of the British Museum, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the National Gallery of London, the Tate Modern, and the Smithsonian. Every Director General of the BBC, editor of the Financial Times, the Wall Street Journal, Time Magazine, the Daily Mirror, the Daily Telegraph, the Times, the Mail on Sunday, and the Daily Mail, ever. No prizes for guessing. They are all 100% male, and always have been. Corners of the world where women are yet to tread. Now, the reasons behind gender inequality in the upper echelons of leadership roles are complex, interconnected, and manifold. Today, I'm just talking about one small element relevant to us as MBAs. That is, what can we, powerless worker bees, actually do to address some of the inherent systemic biases that prevent female progression to the top tier? How can we hack diversity? What are some simple, elegant solutions which will actually make a difference to this complex problem? Before I introduce the three diversity hacks today, why do I care? Let's jump back about 25 years. A suburban garden, two boys aged about 5 and 7 are having a pissing competition to see who can pee highest up the garden wall. The ultimate goal is to pee over the wall into the garden plot, neighbor's plot. They're joined by a tottering 3-year-old sister, tight blonde curls, gamely trying to get involved, follows their lead, you know, stands back, legs akimbo, really goes for it, full throttle, obviously just to triple wee down her leg. And this scene actually repeated itself several times. I didn't show a natural aptitude for learning from failure. Thankfully, this was the first and last time my parents ever had to say, "Darling, you're just a bit different from the boys." Now, you know how some family stories take on a kind of folklore status? They're repeated time and time again at birthdays, holidays, until everyone almost knows them word for word, and somehow they're no less funny. Well, this story took on this status in my family. The reason being, I think, is because it resonates with the broader way in which my family joke about my personality. Corinne thinks she's one of the dudes. Corinne thinks she can take on the world and more. Corinne seems to have no fear of failure or rejection. Corinne's balls are bigger than both her brothers and all her boyfriends combined. Now, these qualities that they joke about in me have taken on a new meaning to me since I entered and have progressed in a fairly male environment of management consulting. I've started to observe the ways in which men and women differ, not so much in skill sets and capabilities, although there are some slight differences, but much more starkly in terms of confidence, self-belief, and a willingness to self-promote. Time and time again, I've seen women shy away from these behaviors across a range of different workplaces. Now, this is why I care, because I find it frustrating seeing fantastic women who could be doing awesome things held back by themselves. Why should you care? Well, primarily you should care because it's well documented that diversity in top teams enhances performance. A Catalyst study indicated that companies with boards with the highest percentage of women outperform those with the lowest percentage, 53% in terms of return on equity, 66% in terms of return on investment. And many, many studies repeat these findings and unpick that it isn't just correlation. Diversity in teams improves the quality of decision making. So if you want your company or your organization to be competitive in the long term, you should care about understanding the complexity of this issue. You should also care because I know all of you have women in your lives, mothers, sisters, partners, friends, who you know are awesome and can go out there and kick ass, and you want to see them fulfilling their potential. So, the issue I've honed in on today, the female disposition to self-promote a bit less than guys, is just one small part of a big issue, big and complex issue. but it's material. And importantly, it's something every single one of us can do something to address. So now to the three hacks. I'm afraid I struggled to find a pithy PG-rated name for this first one. Flash your balls. Apologize for any mental images this conjures, but it really, really is the most succinct way to communicate the message. I'm talking about self-belief, confidence, and a certain boldness. I'm not talking about aggressive self-promotion or a sense of entitlement. Why are these qualities important? Well, there are three specific elements of balls flashing which I've seen women across my workplace and a range of others display less than men. The first is an ownership of achievement. An MBA survey indicated that 70% of women rated their performance as equal to those of their co-workers. And 70% of the guys rated their performance as superior to their co-workers. Research documents this characteristic across a range of different environments. The second quality of ball slashing is articulating your ambitions and really going for them in a strategic way. Many times I had female colleagues come out of their evaluation cycles disappointed they didn't get a promotion, to which their evaluator said, "But I didn't know that's what you wanted." Now, most promotion systems are sophisticated enough that the people who get the promotions generally deserve them. They've worked hard, they've developed, they've proved themselves. But very few evaluation systems are sophisticated enough that they can scoop up those who don't formally put themselves in the process, or perhaps do so formally, but don't actually talk the talk and support it with the strategic, softer stuff. The third element of ball slashing is owning a sense of merit or worthiness. My girlfriends, time and time again, don't apply for jobs which they want and have a great shot at because they don't fulfill every single spec on the job description. And all the guys shoot in an application happily for something they fulfill maybe a quarter for. So, all of you, whatever gender, assess the extent to which you flash your balls. Some of you do it more than enough. I'm probably in that camp. People are like, oh, put them away, you know. But many of you definitely don't do it enough. If you've contributed to a great outcome, make it known to your seniors, evaluators, mentors. If you want a promotion or a new job, say that and be a bit strategic about how you get it. And finally, put yourself in the way of opportunities that you think might be out of your reach, because those are the best ways to grow. If you are a mentor or a manager, impart some of these tips into the juniors in your workplace that you support. Which brings us to our second hack. Mentor beyond mini-me's. So, mentorship and sponsorship. What do I mean by these terms? Mentorship is advising and supporting someone through navigating their careers. Sponsorship is a more proactive term. It means actively pounding the table for someone behind their back or creating opportunities for their progression. Both are incredibly important, but our ability to do both differs according to relationships and contexts. Now, how many people in the room mentor or sponsor someone in their workplace? Please raise your hands. Keep your hand raised if, hold a mentee in your head, and keep your hand raised if they are a different gender or a different ethnicity from you. Well, we've got a strong group here compared to national averages. In general, folks mentor people who they see themselves in. Shared educational backgrounds, shared ethnicity, shared gender, the affinity bias. It's understandable. We naturally hone in on reasons to believe people that we feel we share something in common with. And when I think about the people who I mentored at work, they're invariably ladies who studied philosophy. They're often a bit pale and sickly, a bit like me. I mean, I certainly was drawn to supporting women I saw myself in. I never thought about, you know, that Indian engineering kid who needs just as much support navigating this complex work environment. And on a one-on-one, case-by-case basis, this is fine. But if you look at it in the broader way, it means mentor-mentee relationships look like this. And it means the demographics at the top of the pile are hauling up those just like them through the lower and middle ranks. Now, the affinity bias is incredibly easy to address once we recognize it. It's as simple as doing this. Mentor, sponsor, Choose some mentees, choose several, but make sure at least some of them don't look like you. Now, our first hack focused on what we can do for ourselves. The second focuses on interpersonal relationships. The third looks at what we can do for our organizations more broadly. I call it strip the sexist. Now, I hate to be offensive, but I've warmed you all up a bit by asking you to be ball slashers and all that. I hate to tell you that everyone in this room is a little bit racist or a little bit sexist. And the only way to address that is to start to understand it about ourselves and make a noise about it. Now, this extraordinary year at INSEAD has been really eye-opening for me about my own capacity for bias. I arrived and I was all like, I'm so cosmopolitan and open-minded, and yet time and time again, I have prejudged and been proved wrong, always for the better. So I ask you all to take the Harvard Implicit Association Test, a fantastic tool for helping you understand your biases across different demographic dimensions, such as gender, race, ethnicity, sexuality. Take the test and talk about it with your colleagues. Make some noise about it. There are four specific biases that recur regularly around women in the workplace. The first is the likability bias. For men, success and likability are positively correlated. For women, negatively. Second is the performance evaluation bias. Male performance is consistently overestimated compared to female performance. Third is the performance attribution bias. Women are given less credit for successes and blamed more for failures. Finally, the maternal bias. Motherhood triggers assumptions about lack of commitment to career or lack of competency. So this is the final hack I leave you with. Start to understand your own biases and make a noise about it in your organization. Progressive institutions are making changes to address these biases. Some are stripping names from CVs. Others, including the one I was lucky enough to work at, is introducing workshops and trainings for interviewers, senior managers, evaluators, to help them understand their own biases and help mitigate any impact it might be having on senior decision making. Stripping the sexist is about looking inside you at that prejudgment that sits there. I imagine it like an ugly little gnome. Take his clothes off, look him in the eyes, confront him. This is where we have to start. So a quick recap of the hacks. Flash your balls, practice self-belief and confidence. Mentor beyond mini-me's. Mentor and sponsor, because they're incredibly important to healthy organizations and very fulfilling, but do so beyond the people you see yourselves in. And finally, strip the sexist. Start to understand your own biases and try and create some change within your organization. When I let myself imagine, I imagine a world where there's a bit more diversity in the leadership positions that run politics, business, culture. I imagine what I can do to help bring that world about, how I might try and raise my children. I imagine a courage to have conversations with peers and colleagues, a courage I don't always have. Today, I ask you to imagine this world. Specifically, imagine a world where women have the confidence to ask for what they deserve, where mentor-mentee relationships are a varied mosaic, and where organizations understand the complexity of the barriers to diversity and work hard to try and address them. Take the future in your hands, guys. Thank you very much.